welcome tonight. Are y'all ready to celebrate what Jesus has done for us tonight? And, wow, we serve a good God, a risen Savior, and we just, you know, we take this time on Good Friday to thank the Lord for what He's done for all of us. And, you know, it's interesting today that we call it Good Friday, but back then when it happened, they didn't know necessarily it was good, you know, but thank God we can look back and say, Jesus, You were faithful, You gave Your life, You made a way we could have eternal and abundant life. And so we gather here tonight just to remember what Jesus has done. And so we welcome all of you. We love you very much. Thanks for coming out. And all of you that are joining us online as well, we just, we welcome you. We love you. We're going to have a great Easter weekend. Thanks for starting it off with us tonight, guys.
Amen. It is Good Friday. Thank the Lord. It is Good Friday. And we can stand here with a smile on our face, like Joel said, because we know the end of the story. But we're here to not only honor, I mean, we're here to honor the Lord Jesus Christ. But when you think about the history of where we stand, the people that went before us, the faith that was projected, the struggle and the strength it took to get us here today is incredible. And when you think about the story, we are so blessed to be able to stand here today and say, it's a good day. So that's what we're here to do, to honor history today, His story today, amen? He is a good God, and we are so grateful to be able to stand in His presence. So let's enter in with thanksgiving in our heart, amen? Father, we thank You. We thank You for this Good Friday, and we have come to give honor to You. We have come to lay our hearts before You tonight, Father, and thank You for all that You've done. And so, Lord, as we sing and as we praise, let it be a fragrant offering that goes up to You. Because, God, all we can do is praise You. But that's all You ask us to do, is give You praise and believe in who You are. So, Father, that's what we're going to do tonight. We're going to sing, we're going to praise, and we're going to reverently honor You. And it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen.
That You would take my place. And we're singing, worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Worthy is the Lamb who was slain. Worthy is the King who conquered the grave. Come on, lift it up.
Worthy is the Lamb who was slain.
Come on, declare it tonight.
Worthy is the King.
Worthy, worthy, worthy.
stand before the throne. Can you help me sing this one more time? Christ us so.
Excited to be here tonight. Come on, we get to celebrate the death and resurrection of our Savior Jesus Christ. Is anybody excited? to be here tonight. It's because he died that I can live. It's because of his sacrifice that I've been set free. Amen. Why don't we pray together? God, we thank you for your love for us. We thank you that you sent your son to die for us so that we can have life. We stand here today free because you died. We stand here today having a relationship with you because you died, Jesus. We stand here today completely in awe of you, in your presence, because you made a way for us to come before you, Lord. We thank you for your sacrifice. We thank you, Lord God. We thank you. We thank you. Lord God, we love you today. Father, we give our praise and our worship to you. You are worthy of all of our worship. You are worthy of everything, Lord God. Father, we thank you that we get to celebrate you today. We thank you, Lord God, that no matter what we did in the past, no matter what we're standing in now, Jesus, you died for that. Your blood was shed on the cross for our sins. Thank you that it was for the joy that was set before you that you endured the cross. And so we now have joy in you because you live. Thank you, God, for setting us free. In Jesus' name, can somebody shout, I'm free? Can somebody shout a little louder, I'm free? You know, John 3:16 says, for God so loved the world that he gave his only son, that whoever believes in him should not perish, but have everlasting life. God so loved you that he gave his one and only son. I don't know where you find yourself in life tonight. I don't know where your path or your journey has gone, but God saw you right in the middle of your journey, and he so loved you in the middle of your journey that he gave his only son, that if you'd only believe on him, you wouldn't have perish, but you wouldn't perish, but have everlasting life. And the Bible goes on to say, this is life eternal, that you'd have relationship with God the Father. Eternal life isn't just when I die and I go to heaven. Eternal life starts now in relationship and oneness and unity with God the Father. You can have that through Jesus Christ. And John 3:17 says, for God sent his son into the world, not to condemn the world, but in order that the world might be saved through him. Church, I have good news for you tonight. God didn't send his son so that you could be in shame, so that you could be in bondage, so that you can be in fear, so that you can cower down. God sent his son not to condemn you, but that you may have freedom and life and have it more abundantly. The Bible says that while we were yet sinners, God died for us. Jesus died for you right in the middle of your sin. He knew what you were going to go through. The Bible says, but for the joy that was set before him, you were the joy. I wonder if you can put your hand on your heart and say, I was the joy. I was the joy that Jesus saw. But for the joy that was set before him, he endured the cross. And even now today, he loves you and he sees you. We get a unique opportunity to stand really with the United Church of the world in celebrating who Jesus is and what he did for you and for me. This is an amazing occasion. And while Friday was the day that we celebrate when Jesus died, Friday is good because Sunday is on the way. Friday is good because he rose again. Friday is good because he didn't stay in the grave. Friday is good because the grave was borrowed. Friday is good because he is free. He rose again. And now he sits at the right hand of the Father and he makes intercession for you. And he says, I died for him. I died for her. Jesus paid it all. Jesus paid it all. All your debt is paid. All your sins are forgiven. All you have to do is receive. Thank you, Lord. Thank you for Jesus. Thank you for your sacrifice. Thank you for his death. Thank you for his resurrection. We love you, God. In Jesus' name, and let the church say, amen, amen, and amen. You may be seated.
washed us white as snow. I hope everyone has the elements available to them. We're going to share in the Lord's table today. We're going to share communion together. And I want to invite every believer, because you're welcome at the Lord's table. You know, when we take this, we are proclaiming the Lord's death until he returns. You know, that points us to the future. That points us to what we're looking for. It points us to a hope of what Jesus is going to do because of the resurrection in our lives until he comes back for us. You see, we're not looking at the past, but we're looking at the future. It says, until his return. I want to be eager to not only be waiting for his return, but God, what do you want to do through me before you get back? How many lives do you want me to touch? How do you want me to be transformed? What are you preparing us for? See, we are waiting eagerly, but we're waiting in hope. We're waiting. We're not hopeless. We're waiting in hope. And so that's the exciting part about serving the Lord. If you're waiting on the mountaintop today, that's great. If you're waiting in the valley, that's great, because the Lord is with you. He is with you wherever you go. And when we celebrate this communion, which Jesus actually started with his disciples at the annual feast of the Passover, he proclaimed his own death and resurrection to his disciples. And he told them, when you do this, do it in remembrance of me. Every time you take this bread and drink this cup, remember what I did for you. He knew the distractions of this world. He knew that we would try to be pulled away and taken off course by circumstances, by people, by the culture. He knew. He lived in a culture where people had all kinds of ideas, all kinds of gods, all kinds of idols. And he says, what I'm going to do for you, I want you to remember. And I want you to do it often. And I want you to remember. And then the scripture talks in Corinthians about how when we take this, especially as modern day believers, that we should divide this bread, divide this cup rightly. Which means take the Lord's body aright. So I want to take a pause right now. And I want to say, God, help us to ingest this spiritual food, because that's what it is. It's the way we share in what Jesus did for us, a physical symbol of us sharing in his sacrifice. Before we take this spiritual food, I want us to just pause a moment and just examine ourselves. Do you have aught against anyone? Is there anything that you feel fearful of? Maybe you feel like you're not forgiven or you have some shame. I want you to just let it go right now. Just take a second. Father, thank you. Ask for forgiveness. You said when we do, Father, that you remove our sins as far as the east is from the west, that you remember them no more. And you paid for our sins. Your blood. You sealed our redemption with your blood. I want you to know you're sealed. You are locked up tight in the Lord Jesus Christ and his righteousness. And that's what we're remembering. The hope and the future that he paid for us. On the night that he sat with his disciples, he took the bread, let's take it. He gave thanks to the Father, because he knew what he was going to face. It was like Jesus said, I thank you in advance that the outcome is going to be good. I may go through the valley to get to the other side, but the outcome is going to be good. And it's going to be good for you and me too. He gave thanks and he broke the bread and he said, eat all of this. Then he held the cup He said, this is the blood that I shed for you for the forgiveness of sins. I have taken your sin and wiped it away. Wiped it away. Even when we were yet sinners, the Bible says he died for us. Jeremiah said he died because he saw you and it brought him joy. Even when you didn't know him, he knew you. And I want us to start living like personal children of the Most High God. You're not a foreigner. You're not a stranger. You're a blood-bought child of the Most High God. He's a personal daddy. He shed his blood so that we could live forever and ever. Father, we thank you. And we forget not all of your benefits. You heal all of our diseases. Father, you set us free. You've given us mercy. God, you've empowered us by the blood. Through that resurrection power, we too can overcome because you already overcame. Thank you that you've called us by name. You know every hair on our head. I thank you, Father, that we love you today. And we draw close to you because you've already drawn close to us. We love you. We thank you for this spiritual food, this nutrition that you give our bodies and our spirits. We thank you that our spirits are strong. And you said those spirits are what's going to sustain us. So I speak healing right now in the name of Jesus. I speak breakthrough right now. I speak the benefit of reconciliation right now. I say we have the mind of Christ. That we are close to our God and he is close to us. We thank you, Father, that we will proclaim your death until you return. And we are hopefully awaiting, eager to see what you're gonna do. We bless you and it's in Jesus' name we pray. And everyone said, amen.
Amen. Praise God, everybody. What an incredible night. What incredible music. What incredible atmosphere to be in on Good Friday. Thank you for being here tonight and for honoring the Lord Jesus Christ. My name is Phil Munsey, and I've been a part of Lakewood for going about 23 years. I know you don't see me a lot, but my job is a missionary to pastors. We have hundreds of pastors and hundreds of churches that we send people to that watch us on television. And really, it would be fair to say at least 1 million people have been placed in good Bible local churches, being discipled. And that's what I'm doing. So I'm most of the time on the road, and my wife and I, but I'm a part of like Lakewood. In fact, I volunteered for 10 years, so I'm a part of the elite volunteer gang. And I honor my pastors, I honor the Osteens, the whole family. I love Pastor Joe and Victoria. I've been in the ministry 50 years, and almost half of that's been with this young man right here and his beautiful wife. Happy birthday, Victoria, yesterday. Happy birthday. We honor you. Father, thank you for your grace. Thank you that tonight, in the next few moments, there's going to be a shift. There's going to be a change. There's going to be a breakthrough. There's going to be a bursting forth, a fresh hope and confidence. And for that, I give you the praise and thank you. And everybody say amen.
Amen.
You may be seated. I am going to share with you one of the most profound statements written in the Bible. A statement that if you can receive and believe, will literally transform your life. It is a statement that was actually made on the night that we've come here tonight to honor in retrospect. We know Sunday's coming, but it is important for us to pause and to take in what happened 2,000 years ago. This statement that Christ himself made and will be in our text in a few moments are these words: you cannot fail. Think about those words. You, yeah, I'm talking to you, you, and yes, even you. You cannot fail. That's not a statement of some motivational speaker. That's not some hype. That is your Lord, Jesus Christ, telling you, you cannot fail. Let that resonate in your spirit. Reason through that statement in and throughout your mind. I cannot fail. How would our lives be affected if we could let that get in our spirit? That failure, the fear of failure, the shame of disappointments and regrets. If somehow we could leap over those feelings and have a fresh confidence that God is for us and with us and that we cannot fail, how would that change our life? How would we dream? How would we have hope? And what kind of ambition would rise up in us if we had a sense that the fear of failure and the consequences of when things don't go right, that somehow we could have the confidence that I cannot fail? What relationships would you pursue? What risk would you be willing to take if you knew you could not fail? Now, let's be clear. We will make mistakes. We will have regrettable decisions. We will face disappointments. There'll be missteps and mistakes. And when those things happen, you must guard yourself, protect yourself from failure creeping in to your heart, because failure is toxic. It will taint you, it'll tilt you, it will bend you, it will change and give you a distorted view of what God has put in your heart. You must never let failure be yours. Don't make fail yours. Mistakes, yes. Things that we regret, yes. And we really need to see those efforts as being mistakes. Mistakes. A few years ago, several years ago, my wife and I were attending a movie, and it was there was a part of the movie where Tom Cruise was the star, and Renee, what her last name, I don't know what it is, but anyway. There was a touching part of the movie where Tom Cruise looks at Renee, and the moment is filled with tension and expectation, and Tom looks at Renee and says, "You complete me." And I could feel my wife's hand squeezing my hand. And I looked over, and it looked like maybe she had tears in her eyes. I even felt like maybe I had something in my eye for a moment. And as she squeezed my hand, for some reason, I became a little intimidated. It was like she was saying, "Why can't you ever say anything like that to me?" And I started this argument in my head. I was like, well, first of all, that's not his line. Somebody gave it to him. I could be romantic too if I had a scriptwriter. Say this. Right? And then I thought, you know, I guarantee you that he had many takes, many mistakes. I see it in my mind. You weren't there, I wasn't there, but I have the mic. This is the way I see it. Action. You complete me? Cut. Tom, put some feeling in it. Action. You complete me? Cut. Let's do that again, Tom. You. What's my line? I can see this going on. Finally, he gets it together, and the editors and everybody puts it all together, and at the end, we're crying at this romantic man whose lines were not his, and it took him 50 mistakes. And that's the way we need to view the things in our life that we go after, and they don't turn out the way that we had anticipated, or worse, what other people had put expectations on us. And we really need to see them as mistakes, that they are regrettable, disappointing, but they are not failures, because Jesus has said to us, you cannot fail. It's that intimidation. It's what the devil does when we do make mistakes and disappointments and regrettable decisions. It's what he does to us. Grinds our minds and torments every moment. Makes us relive those mistakes. That police report. That DUI. That being in your credit. Or bankruptcy. That legal matter that you lost in dispute, that devastating divorce, the estranged children that you're not speaking to. All of these things happen in our life, and at that moment, we have to choose to say, I am not a failure, I cannot fail. And this is really the message of Good Friday. And one of the responsibilities, as Pastor Victoria said, is that we are to remember that first original Last Supper. It's an obligation we have to meditate, to introspect and retrospect our heart and mind back to that Last Supper. Now, here's the thing about the Bible scriptures. We tend to romance them. We tend to make the scriptures like kind of surreal, and it's all perfect, and it's all kind of all so nice and neat, and we're doing that out of respect, but we do ourselves a disservice because often it's messy, it's real, it's raw. And the Last Supper was in fact that. It was a mess. It was a hot mess. That Last Supper was not like Leonardo da Vinci made that famous painting. In fact, my wife and I are going to Italy in 2 days to celebrate 46 years of marriage. I'm gonna see that thing. It's colorful, it's spectacular, but it's not reality. The disciples were clueless. They had no idea that on that night, history would be made and humanity would be marked. I see it in my mind. The disciples are bickering, really. They're debating, they're arguing, they're bantering, they're belittling one another. Oh, I'll be the greatest. I'll sit at his right hand and left hand. I'll be the first to draw the sword. Oh, yes, if there's ever a fight. Oh, yeah, they were belittling, and boasting to one another. And the room was filled with bewilderment. And oh, yes, the stench of betrayal was in the room. And Jesus was on his hands and knees washing the feet of the disciples. Dirty, dusty, disgusting, stinky feet of the disciples. No one seemed to grasp the seriousness of the night except, Judas. Judas Iscariot. As he sat there, disconnected, disengaged, he knew what was happening. I can see him now underneath the table, shuffling the bag of silver coins from the bag to the hand, back to the 26, 27, 28, 29, 30 pieces of silver. What a shame, what a sham. The price of a slave. That's how he would betray the Lord. Underneath the table, from whence the high priest had given him that money, from underneath the table. Perhaps the very table that Jesus turned and tossed earlier in his ministry. Now Jesus rises up from washing the feet, takes his place at the seat, and a hush is quilted over the room. And Jesus says these words, "I have long desired to have this Passover supper with you, though it will be a night of suffering. I've longed for this night. I know you've eaten, but I've bread here, and I want you to take this bread, and I want you to eat it, for it is my body, and drink the cup. It is my blood that is being poured out. This is the new covenant for the forgiveness of sin." Judas, having taken a larger piece than others, has taken his bread now and slides his hands underneath the arms of John the Beloved sitting next to Jesus, about to dip his bread into the cup. Jesus catches him out of the corner of his eyes and says, "And one of you will betray me this night." The room erupts with self-defense pleads. "Is it I? Is it I?" All of them, each, "Is it I? Is it me? Is it I?" By that time, Judas has dipped his bread in the cup and Jesus now his. Their breads kiss. Jesus says, "It is he who has dipped his bread into my cup. He is the one that shall betray." Judas snatches his hands away from the cup, cowards in his seat like a coward, slouches down and looks at Jesus. Like a child caught with his hands in the cookie jar, guilt on his face like the crumbs and the wine on his well-groomed beard. "Is it me?" Jesus doesn't even look. "You have spoken. Now go do what you're going to do." He slithers across the back hallway like the snake that he is, finds the hallway, darts down the steps and into the dark night, and now it's set in motion. The betrayal, the crucifixion, full throttle. There'll be the mob crowd, there'll be the mock trial, there'll be the pulling of the beard, there'll be the spitting, there'll be the crowning of the thorns, there'll be the beatings on his back, there'll be the crucifixion. Disciples still really don't know what's going on. Jesus, to take the attention off of Judas, says, in fact, all of you will betray me this night. For it is written that the shepherd will be smitten and the sheep will scatter. Simon burst forth out of his seat. Not me! Oh, not me! I will die with you. I will go to prison with you. Peter, sit down. And now the text. Simon, Simon, Satan has desired to sift you as wheat. But I have prayed for you, that your faith fail not. And when you do fall, when you do make mistakes, and when you do make wrong decisions, when you fall, you will rise, you will strengthen the brethren, because you cannot fail. Because when I pray, the Father hears me. My prayers cannot fail, neither can you. You cannot fail. They sing a hymn and walk. Jesus walks into that night. I want you to hear those words of Jesus. I want them to resonate. I want you to dwell on them. I want you to help me get past your head right now. Those voices in your head, the bad choices that you've made. I know exactly. I've been doing this a long time. I've been in church for 68 years. I am your brother. I know what Christians battle with. They battle with shame and blame. They battle with guilt and regret. And I'm competing against voices that have told you you're a failure. Didn't happen. You'll never achieve your dreams. Not you. You've blown it too many times. And yet today, by the Holy Spirit, I'm believing that God's words will penetrate past every voice, past every bad choice, and you will hear these words in your heart. I cannot fail because somebody's praying for you. Hebrews 7:25 says that God is able to save us to the utmost, and he, Jesus Christ, ever liveth to make intercessions for you. I don't know how it works, but all day long, Jesus has been praying for you. When you got up this morning, it felt like his mercies were new. Of course they were, because he had been praying for you. He ever lives to pray for you. That's why I can say to you today, you cannot fail because he is praying. His prayers cannot fail, neither can you. You must not let failure penetrate. You must not embrace the label of failure. You must resist what maybe society and others have tried to put on you, because the label will mark you. It will marginalize you. Failure is toxic. And it must be rejected. It must not be received. because it will limit you. It will lock you in, lock you out. It will hinder you from the things that God has called you to do, the things of which he's praying for you, that you won't get discouraged, that you won't, that when you slip up and fail and fall, that you're going to get right back up again. He's praying that for you. Years ago, I heard a story by Zig Ziglar, who I admired, wonderful motivator. He told a story about the flea trainer. The flea trainer was the man that knew how to train fleas, control them. He would capture the fleas, put them in a jar, twist the lid on the jar, and those fleas would go up and down, trying to get out. Up and down, bouncing up against that lid, over and 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 over. But now they've been trained. The lid has hit them too many times. They won't hit it any longer. Now the flea trainer screws the lid off of the jar, and those fleas will never escape because they have accepted the lid. Who am I talking to right now that have compromised your dreams, your ambitions, your goals? I'm too old. There's too many this, too many. Who am I talking today that it hit the lid one too many times, and now you have settled in for just going through the motion without the emotion? And I've come to encourage you today. I've come to tell you that the Last Supper and Good Friday is good because we are reminded that we can not fail. Jesus has prayed for you. You cannot fail. Somehow we have a hard time really believing that. We hear it so much here at this church. This is one of the most incredible churches I've ever been exposed to in my life. In church, so positive, so reaffirming. You're told constantly, God loves you. God's on your side. I mean, honestly, don't do it. Let me save you time. But I've been to hundreds of churches, and I watch dozens of services every week as part of my research and what I do. You don't get this everywhere. But why is it that the conflict is still there? That we leave feeling good, but within hours we're already withdrawing ourselves, already feeling the guilt and the shame. And here's what I think why. And I'd like to ask you to give me 2 minutes to explain something to you. And then there's going to be an anointing released upon your life. But you see, if you've been in church for a while, you hear all this about God loves you, God's on your side, God forgives you all your sins. You hear all that, and you, yes, 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 I believe it. But then you read the Old Testament, and then you read the book of Revelation, and then you read some scriptures that make you think that God is a consuming fire. He is. That God is a God of justice, which means he judges. You read these things in the Old Testament about how God brought judgment, and it's like, which God is it that I'm serving? Is it the God of the Old Testament? Is it... And you feel the tension of a God that loves you, but also a God that is holy and righteous and must be honored and feared. And that tension polarizes us. And here's why, and I'm going to give you 50 years of accumulated study to help you understand how God judges. And if you can get this simple three levels of judgment in your head and your heart, it will save you from ever, ever being tempted to feel like a failure. The three judgments are this: the judgment of sin, or sinners; the judgment of sons, or children of God; the judgment of servants, and service. So you look at God and you see there is the judgment of sin. You see, we are all sinners. Sinners are not so much what we do, but who we are. And we're all sinners because the Bible says, because one man sinned, all have been tainted. David said, I was born in shapen in iniquity. Yes, it doesn't seem fair, but Adam sinned. And now all of us carry that iniquity in our bloodline. Up until about 60 years ago, we just had to accept it as theology. But now science now proves that in every deed there is a seed. And in every deed there is a seed. In every seed there is a deed. In every deed there is a seed. In every seed there is a deed. And the vicious cycle continues. The bloodline traces, tracks, and transfers every deed. In every deed there is a seed. So we come into this world with accumulated sin. And the Bible says we stand before God to be judged. We are to see sin and death we have already been identified with. And that's why tonight you came, because you came to remind yourself that on that horrible Friday that we now call Good Friday, Jesus became sin. He didn't commit sin. He never violated. He was perfect. He never sinned. Get this. This will change your life. He never sinned, and yet he became sin. How is that? Because what he did was not based on his behavior. It was not based on anything he did. It's what he stepped into. He stepped in a position of saying, I have become sin. God, through Christ, received the sacrifice of sin. Christ became sin. And it was so real. And if you ever want to know what sin looks like, let your imagination see the cross. Because when we take communion, it's very sanitized and appropriately so. The bread prepared, cut for longevity, often taken with passionless brevity. So pretty. But you know that the body and the suffering is not a pretty sight. I will tell you, honestly, if you study history, if you've watched the movie by Mel Gibson, The Passion of Christ, that's a Disney movie compared to what history says is the real crucifixion. It was so effective that in that moment when Jesus, who knew no sin, never committed sin, became sin, the prophet said that God was so nauseated, so offended at Jesus being sin. The Bible says that God smote him. And in that moment, Jesus on the cross said, my God, why have you forsaken me? And really, in that moment, it was the most triumphant moment of Good Friday because the transfer happened. He had become sin. Watch this. You got to get this. This is it right here. He became sin so that we, who are sinners, who deserve the judgment of sin, can become the righteousness of God. Not that we did it. Not that we earned it. Friend, your righteousness is as filthy rags. You're where you are tonight. Past judgment of your sins. Past, present, and future. Because he became sin so that you could become righteousness. And you're not going to believe this. Oh, you're going to clap maybe. You might say amen. But most of us really struggle with this statement. When God sees you, he sees the righteousness of Jesus Christ. Yeah. It's hard to believe. That was a PGA clap. When you really believe it, I'll get a Super Bowl one out of you. But too late now. It's all right. We're past that now. If I could get you to believe that no matter what you do, no matter what mistakes, no matter, I know what you did. You know what you did. I know what I do. And yet when I come before God, I'm to come boldly because any other way is an insult against grace. Because I'm assuming that I'm coming before God because He's going to judge me for my sins. But when I'm a believer, it's hard for me. It's hard for me. It's hard for me to come boldly because I feel so much shame. I feel so stupid. I feel so unpredictable, so unworthy. It's hard. I feel like it's hard. Father, I come boldly. There's no other way to come because I have passed the judgment of sin and of death. It's passed for me. It's passed for me. But then there's another judgment. It's called the judgment of sons. We're all called sons of God, daughters, children, but we're all called sons of God. And that judgment is what God deals with us every day. It's where God deals with the consequences of our sin without the condemnation. So we sin, and God has already cleansed us as we walk in the light as He is the light. The blood of Jesus is always is cleansing us from all unrighteousness. But the consequences of our sin, God allows it to work its work in us, to judge us, because all good fathers chasten their children. You're not a child of God if you're not accepting the chastening of the Father who says, not right, we need to make this right. You got to come to accountability for this. So vertically, I am at right standing with God. Horizontally, I got some work. But here's the key. If you don't believe you're the righteousness of God, when God corrects you, when you face difficulties, you'll think it's because God doesn't love you. You'll condemn yourself. You'll stop coming to church. You'll stop praying because you messed up. And God is saying, oh no, the judgment of sin is past. Now you let me work on you and let me judge you so I can perfect you. And the last judgment is where I want to close in on, the judgment of servants. In the end, when you face God, He will not be judging you for your sins. There's not a book there going, all right, let's go back to, nope, done. We sang it tonight. You'll stand faultless before Him. And He will not be there telling you how difficult you made it on Him when you just wouldn't listen. No. That judgment is present and then will be past. Only one judgment remains. What did you do with the dreams I gave you? What did you do with the talent I gave you? What did you do with the desires I put in your heart? But God, I was afraid you didn't love me. No. I passed that a long time ago. That's why Jesus said to Simon Peter, I know who you are. When I called you, when I chose you, I saw the end from the beginning. I know who you are. But I have chosen to love you. And you know what He said? And He's saying it to you today. There's nothing you can do that surprises God. There's nothing you can do that makes God love you any less than He does right now. Nothing you could ever do, including nothing righteous can you do to make God love you any more than He does right now. No, on that day, they'll say, why did you waste time on guilt and shame? I gave you a dream. Why did you let correction and difficulties, and sometimes I even would let the enemy do the dirty work and test you? Why did you let that get you down? Why did you quit? Why'd you give up on your dreams? Because that's all that matters in the end. The Bible says that some will be judged by fire. In other words, their whole life will be burnt up because they lived it in fear and intimidation. No condemnation, just saying. When some people face God, God will say, well, done. Others He'll say, well done, because you didn't quit. You didn't let go. When you almost gave in, you remembered the words of Jesus on that Good Friday. I have prayed for you that your faith would not fail. You cannot fail. You cannot fail. And I think of Elijah the prophet who died. He was a miracle working man. And he died, and the stories told in Kings where the enemy came and a young soldier that had died had to be hid. And they put him on top of Elisha's grave accidentally. And when the dead soldier's body hit the bones of Elisha, he resurrected and came to life. And I've heard that preached so many times, like, wow, what a miracle. But you know what really was happening there? He died with a miracle in him still. He had one more thing in him, one more dream, one more miracle. And he went to his grave. Don't do that. Not when your sins have been forgiven. Not when God loves you enough to help you. No. He has called you. He's praying for you. You cannot fail. What lid is holding you back? What label is holding you back? May it be released. And may even now the blood of Jesus and the grace of our Lord God Almighty through Jesus Christ and the communion of the Holy Spirit set upon you even right now until you can feel the lifting of the shame and the burden and the condemnation. Feel light again on your feet, and you feel light again on your dreams. So be it. Let me pray for you. Father, today I'm talking to people that have faced a lot of pain, a lot of problems, issues that they hide it well, but their sleepless hours and restless nights, trying to undo the mistakes, the disappointments. But today you have sent me to tell them, you have prayed for them, and they cannot fail. Give me just a couple moments. I want to, with every head bowed and eyes closed, I want to ask you a question. If your heart was to stop beating, and you came to the end and you faced Almighty God, would you be at peace? Do you know where you would spend eternity? If not, we're not here to condemn anybody. We're here to tell you that God has already forgiven you of all of your sins. All you need to do is accept the free gift of salvation. And that comes through a personal relationship with Jesus Christ. That's you. I'm going to give you an opportunity to step in into that beautiful relationship with Jesus Christ. Or maybe you are a Christian, but you've allowed sin, condemnation. You've allowed life. You've grown cold in your heart towards God, and you need tonight a fresh new start, a new beginning. I'm going to give you a chance in just a moment to stand right where you are. Hear me, some of you are saying, I'll do it later. The scriptures teach us that now, when you feel this, what you're feeling now, that's the time of salvation. Oh, I don't want to stand, I hear some of you say, because I don't want to embarrass myself. I don't want to make a promise I can't keep. Listen to what the scripture says. If you'll not be ashamed of him, he won't be ashamed of you. You make the stand, you make the choice, he'll give you the power to live it. If that's you, you want to come and be saved today. You want to pass the judgment of sin and come at peace with God, or you need a fresh new beginning right now, I want you with boldness to take a stand. Stand to your feet right now. God is going to do a miracle for you all over the building, all over the building. You're tired of being cold. You're tired of being lukewarm. You're tired of guilt and shame. You're ready. Come on. Come on. Come on. Come on. It's Good Friday. This is a good time. Young people, children. You feel something going on? Your heart feels like it's pounding? Yeah, that's the Holy Spirit saying, this is your night. There's more. There's more. Yeah. Come on, Lakewood, give them a great hand. This is what it's all about. Beautiful. Remain standing. As Pastor Joe says, we're proud of you. We know this took a lot of courage. And I just want to challenge you as I lead you in prayer that this is a new beginning, a fresh start. Pray with me, everyone. Say, Lord Jesus, I believe you died on the cross for my sins. I repent of my sins. And God raised you from the dead. And that same power is going to live in me. I receive the gift of eternal life. Come on, give God praise. Give God praise. Now let me tell you something. And I just thank you for your patience. Just 90 more seconds. Let me just tell you, we're proud of you. This is the key. Very important you hear this. The first year, the first 12 months of your Christian walk, the shape and tone and foundation happens in that first year. Get to church every week, every time the doors, volunteer, get involved. If you set that first year in motion, you will live a victorious life. I read that somewhere. You are victorious. Come on, stand with me. I'm about to release you. Come on, give God praise one more time. What a night. Music, communion, encouragement. I want to remind all the children that there'll be 100,000 eggs in this building, right? Tomorrow at 1:00. Man, if I wasn't going to Italy, I'd be here. I want to remind you that at 8:15 and then 11 will be the greatest opportunity you'll ever have to get friends and family to the house of God. There's a seat ready for them. There's a salvation call ready for them. It's going to be a glorious Easter. May the Lord bless you. May the Lord keep you. May you walk in complete forgiveness. May you understand that your greatest days are ahead of you. And please hear the words of Jesus. I am praying for you. You cannot fail. God bless you.
Thank you again for joining us here at Lakewood Church on Joel Osteen Radio. We love having you here. Thank you so much for listening today. Let's take a listen to some of the highlights from this week's edition of Joel Osteen Live, recorded earlier this week here on Joel Osteen Radio.
Are actually going to amount to anything, I want to encourage you to know that God is faithful and that he who began a work in you, that good work, he's faithful to complete it. And so as you lean on him and as you trust him, as you surrender to him, you will see a day, and that day is coming where that depression will turn to joy, where that anxiety will turn to peace, where that confusion will turn to clarity. I know God's able to do it. Don't doubt him. Hang on. I believe that your miracle is on the way.
I love that, David. That's my friend David Hernandez. You can check out his YouTube channel or on Instagram is where I